So, what is the Orlando Furioso, and what's so great about it? Orlando Furioso is a rollicking tale of ladies, cavaliers, of love, and of arms, and that's the first line of the poem. What makes it great, really, are its dazzling adventures, its globe-trotting characters, and its fantastical creatures. But equally appealing are its playful seriousness. There's a seriousness to the Orlando Furioso as well, and its ever-changing tone that never stays still and never bores, moving from the comic to the tragic. And also of great importance, I think, in the Orlando Furioso are the very keen perspectives it offers on love and war, on reason and madness, on life and literature. Though it was written in the 16th century, as Laurie told us earlier, it's actually set in 8th century Europe, against the backdrop of the wars between Charlemagne, who's the king of the Franks, the king of the Christian empire, and Agramante, who's the legendary king of Africa. So the battle between the Christians and the Saracens rages on throughout the Orlando Furioso, but that's not really the main focus of attention. The main focal points are really the knights and the villains, the damsels and the damsel warriors, who crisscross the continental landmass, sometimes venturing far beyond it, in fact, each following the things that they most desire. There are hundreds of such characters. But that doesn't make the whole poem a chaotic narrative tangle by any manner or means. On the contrary, it's a rich and colourful tapestry made up of fine, carefully woven narrative strands. Now, it's Ariosto himself who offers the metaphor of the tapestry as a figure for his own poem. And as you read the Orlando Furioso, you can just imagine those nimble fingers darting here and there, spinning splendid yarns one at a time. He follows, of course, an underlying design, breaking off threads here to pick them up there, taking care never to weave so far ahead that other parts cannot be added or developed later on. And the end result is an array of independent but interrelated plot lines, blending in to the visually pleasing background of the broader frame. One of the main characters that we met this morning with is Orlando, of course, Orlando of the title. Now, Orlando was the hero of an old tale that had long been told and retold across Europe in song, words, music, and art. The origin of his age-old story was a historical event that took place in the year 778, when Roland, the nephew of Charlemagne, the Christian emperor, was ambushed and killed in a famous battle at Roncesvalles. And from the year 778 on, Roland was commemorated in successive legends that passed from France and to Spain, to Italy, and back. And in Italian versions of the tale, Roland, who you see here, this is a tapestry, the Battle of Roncesvalles tapestry, made more or less contemporaneously with the writing of the Orlando Furioso. And you see there the character Roland in the left-hand side. But when he comes to Italy, he changes his name to Orlando, and he acquires an Italian pedigree. Under Ariosto's pen, however, his story was to change forever. Ariosto adds to Orlando's story, cose non dette in prosa mai né in rima, things never said before in prose or in rhyme. The man who once was deemed so wise was now shown to go mad for love, to harbour human feelings and human failings. It's hard for us today, really, to appreciate just what a bold move this was on Ariosto's part and how thrilling it must have been for the first readers of the Orlando Furioso. It's true that an earlier poet, Matteo Maria Boiardo, had made Orlando fall in love in his Orlando Innamorato, which was published when Ariosto was 20 years old in 1494. But to take the supreme hero of the European tradition and to bring him down a further notch or two and to render him insane was very radical indeed. Orlando's madness doesn't happen until halfway through the poem. For the first 23 cantos, or chapters, cantos as they're called, of Orlando Furioso, Orlando is stubbornly in love with the exotic princess from the East, Angelica, who we met this morning as well. And he believes that she loves him, despite the fact that she's always running away from him. And despite the fact that he has a powerful dream telling him to abandon all hope of her, he nonetheless persists in his belief. Till it becomes an obsession, he abandons his duty to Charlemagne and devotes himself entirely to the pursuit of Angelica across Europe. But then, halfway point of the poem, he comes face to face with unassailable evidence that Angelica is in love with someone else, a lowly foot soldier of a pagan army called Medoro, with whom she falls in love as she heals his battle wounds. Orlando finds this out in a pleasant meadow, where he came across the inscriptions on the trees in Angelica's handwriting, the names Angelica and Medoro written in 100 places, united by 100 love notes. In denial at first, he casts around for alternative explanations. Can she perhaps be inventing this Medoro? Perhaps by this name she means me? He leaves the place with his puny hopes still just about intact and stumbles to an inn where a well-intentioned herdsman tries to cheer him up by telling him the story of a happy pair who had sheltered in his home. To prove the truth of the story, the herdsman produces a bracelet given to him by the young woman to thank him for his hospitality. But when Orlando sees the bracelet, he recognizes it as the one that he gave Angelica as the first love gift that he had ever given her. This was a token of his love, and this evidence, says the narrator, proves to be the axe which took his head off his shoulders at one stroke. He experiences what we would likely call nowadays a nervous breakdown. His vital spirits escape by the ducts that lead to the eyes. Ardour keeps his heart burning, though never consumed by the flames. He loses his bearings and all sense of self. I am not, he says, non son più quel che paio in viso. I am not that which my face proclaims me. The man who was Orlando is dead and buried. He slips into a three-day catatonic state, then wakes to a sort of animal lack of consciousness. Stripping off his clothes that marked his former civility, he charges wildly into the woods like a beast. Now, I said that the Orlando Furioso is characterized by its ever-changing tone from the tragic to the comic, and I've chosen here really to emphasize the tragic and the story of Orlando, which we have seen this morning has a very strong impact on the history of musical writing. And in part I choose that because it seems to be the theme that my students pick up on most nowadays. It seems to be the theme that speaks to them in our own age of reason and unreason and delusions and delusional thoughts and behaviours versus kind of rational approaches to the world that we live in. But also I think, because I hope later David will bring out the other strain, the comic strain, of the Orlando Furioso. I also choose this tragic strain because I think it appears in very much in the work of Shakespeare, and in particular one of the greatest of Shakespeare's plays, Othello. Of course, unrequited love and jealousy are universal themes in literature, but Ariosto's particular treatment of those themes leaves its mark on Shakespeare's play. Othello, as I'm sure you all know, tells the story of an esteemed Moorish general in the Venetian army who's elevated to high social standing by his marriage into a patrician family. On top of the world at the start of the play, the hero is preyed upon by his scheming confidant, Iago, who leads him to suspect his innocent wife, Desdemona, of betrayal, of infidelity. The play's five acts chart the course of his subsequent downfall, encapsulating the humiliation and degradation as he is consumed by pathological jealousy, a passion most eloquently described by the perfidious Iago, who coins that immortal phrase we all now so well nowadays, the green-eyed monster. Jealousy is a main theme of Othello, as I'm sure you all know, and Orlando offers a model for Othello's jealousy, but especially for its climactic crisis, caused, as in Orlando Furioso, by his discovery of a discarded love gift in an unexpected place. In Ariosto, it was a bracelet that drove him mad. In Othello, it's the handkerchief that he gave to Desdemona as his first love gift, and that he later sees in the possession of Cassio, her supposed lover. Like Angelica's bracelet, Desdemona's handkerchief has provided the material evidence of infidelity. It speaks against her with other proofs, as Iago says. And it's this discovery, this recognition scene, that sends Othello hurtling down the track that ends tragically in murder. He suffocates Desdemona, and in suicide, he runs himself through with his own dagger. Othello is rendered incoherent and rambling by the physical object, in the same way that Orlando lost his former eloquence. And it's highly likely that Shakespeare drew directly on Ariosto's once wise hero, both for his recognition scene and for the way in which Othello slips into a trance, as you see in the stage directions here. He falls in a trance after rambling about his sorrow, and, as Iago says, breaks out to savage madness. Now, all of this is not to put Ariosto at the source of everything in the whole world and to claim that the Italians did it first and do it better, but Shakespeare did learn something important, some important moves from Ariosto. Now, Shakespeare's Othello can hardly be described as derivative, but what the point here is rather to pay tribute to the generative force of Ariosto's masterful text as it portrays and explores human sentiments and their sometime tragic consequences. Reading Othello from the perspective of Ariosto's poem is like witnessing a meeting of great minds across time and through literature about things that really matter. Ariosto's exploration of our need to patrol the boundaries between appearances and reality, between reason and irrationality, between our desiring selves and the external circumstances of the world that we live in, has a profound effect on the English bard. Like when a stone hits the surface of the water and exerts its influence far from the point of impact. Shakespeare, in turn, participates himself in that creative process, making new words out of old and turning old stories into new in the transcultural, transtemporal investigation of just what it is that makes us human. So what I love most about the Orlando Furioso, and indeed about Shakespeare, is that the circumference of its exerted influence, those ripples emanating when the poem first hits the surface of your consciousness, continues to undulate long after the book is closed, haunting you with visions of the human mind and heart that have lost nothing of their acuity in the 500 years since they first appeared.